The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. At that time, Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. He fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was hungry. The tempter approached and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command that these stones become loaves of bread." He said in reply, "It is written, one does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes forth from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and made him stand on the parapet of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and with their hands they will support you, lest you dash your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "Again it is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test." Then the devil took him up to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in their magnificence. And he said to him, "All these I shall give to you if you will prostrate yourself and worship me." At this, Jesus said to him, "Get away, Satan. It is written, the Lord your God shall you worship, and him alone shall you serve." Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered to him. The Gospel of the Lord.
How many of you can remember playing hide-and-seek as a child? I think all of us played the game at least a number of times in our childhood. I still continue to play that game with my staff and hide and see if they can find me when they need something done around the office. Usually it's in the house laying prostrate, usually, you know. I remember a story when I was a kid, remember an instance when we were playing hide-and-seek in the neighborhood where I grew up, and there were lots of kids in the neighborhood and a few cousins that lived down the street. And so there was about a dozen of us or so playing hide and seek on a summer night, and it began to get a little bit darker and darker, and we were out just playing, and you know how it goes. Every game somebody would go out and find everyone and somebody else would be it. And we realized that after about three or four games of hide and seek that my sister wasn't coming back each time. She was out there somewhere, and we couldn't find her. And so we all began to look. Instead of just one person going out and seeking, everybody was out looking for my sister, Sarah. Then we called on Mom through the neighborhood, and Mom came running out, and everybody was in a panic because it had probably been a couple hours since any of us had seen Sarah. Well, come to find out, she was in a neighbor's garage hiding down the street, and she kind of thought the game was still going. And when we found her, she kind of peeked her head out and said, "Is it over now?" That was only the beginning of my troubles with my sister, and not to count the time that I cut her hair or the other things that I did to my sister that happened that always seemed to get blamed on me when I was young. You know, you're supposed to be watching your sister. You're the oldest. The reason why I tell this story is because I think we spend a lot of our life hiding, don't we? We spend a lot of our life hiding from our sin, hiding from whatever different things in our lives, the things that we're ashamed of in our lives, hiding from the particular temptations in our lives, whether those be towards material things or eating habits or even deeper things and deeper temptations in our lives. We all know that the world offers plenty of temptations. But I think we run and hide a lot from the things in our lives that we don't like or that we find difficult. We run and hide. And I think as we hear this reading this weekend and as we embark on this first Sunday of Lent, and Jesus goes out into the desert for 40 days and fasts, and then he's tempted by the devil, I think what the lesson for us is that we can't keep hiding, right? And Lent, or our desert experience, offers us an opportunity to go out, and even an invitation to go out into the desert and to let everything be known. Because the interesting thing about the desert is you can't hide, can you? Have you ever been to a desert? There's no place to hide. There's no garage like my sister hid in. There's nowhere to hide in the desert. You might be able to lay down and throw a little sand over yourself and act like you're a sand dune. I make a pretty good sand dune myself. But we can't hide in the desert. And so intentionally, we go out into the desert in these 40 days, not alone, but with Jesus, so that whatever is inside of us that we've been hiding from might be exposed. Whatever the temptations are in our life, those things might come to the surface, right? Because when you're in the desert, everything is known. You have to search from within yourself to figure out what am I hungry for, what am I thirsty for, what am I longing for in my life, and why am I giving in to these temptations, which eventually lead me into sin. So what we get in our gospel reading this weekend is an example of how Jesus himself went out into the desert and how Jesus was tempted by the devil in many of the same ways that we're tempted, and how he overcame those temptations. But first of all, we have to make clear that temptation is not sin, right? Temptation might lead us into sin, and when we fall into that temptation and give in to the temptation, it becomes sin. But Jesus himself was tempted, right? But Jesus himself was sinless. So the temptation is not the sin, it is giving in to the temptation that causes us to sin. And then what do? We run even further out into the desert, right? We run even further to hide. First, we hide because of whatever the temptations are in our lives that we don't want to deal with. And then the second reason that we might hide is because we've actually given in to those temptations. So the encouragement for us this weekend as we reflect on our own temptations, please God, that's an opportunity for all of us in this Lent, an invitation for us to go into the desert where we can't hide, and to just lay those temptations of our life before Jesus. To unite those to Jesus who went into the desert and overcame the temptations of the devil. So Jesus teaches us, I think in his three temptations, we can find assurance and confidence and a model in Jesus in three different ways. And the first one is the truth. Jesus knew the truth. This is why the devil wasn't able to tempt him in any of the three ways. Whether it was for prestige and power, glory and honor, materialistic things, it didn't matter what the devil tried to offer. Jesus knew the truth about who he was. Jesus knew the truth of what he was doing in the desert, that he was uniting himself and giving himself as a model for us in our temptations. But he knew the truth. That was the first way that Jesus was able to undergo those temptations and to not give in, is because he trusted in that truth, the truth of who he was as the Son of God. Because what did the devil say? If you are the Son of God, then... But Jesus knew the truth. It goes back to the first reading today from the book of Genesis. We're reminded of the sin of Adam and Eve in the garden. And what did the devil do? He tempted them with an untruth. He tempted them with a lie that wasn't the truth about who they are, their identity of who they are as beloved sons and daughters. They had everything in communion with God in the garden. There was no sin. There was no separation between them and God. They walked, in some scripture translations, say face to face with God. Everything that was God's was theirs. They were in total and complete communion with him. But the devil lied to them and said, hey, do you want to be like God's? Hey, do you want to have power? Do you want to know the difference between right and wrong? Hey, do you want more authority in your life? Do you want to be lied to about who you are? And they fell for the trick, right? So what happens immediately after they let the tempter tempt them into eating the fruit? They hid, didn't they? They recognized that they were naked and they sewed clothes out of fig leaves and they hid themselves. The same thing happens with us. When we recognize that there's a temptation in our lives, oftentimes we run from it, especially when we give in to those temptations of the evil one. But the temptation isn't the bad thing, it's the sin. The temptation is what offers us an opportunity to grow in virtue. St. Philip Neri would say, God, when he is ready to increase in us a particular virtue, he allows temptations in our life, vices in our life, in order to increase in us a courage and a strength and to reveal the truth about us and who we are. But Jesus knew the truth, and that's one of the first ways that Jesus was able to overcome temptation. He wasn't about to believe the lies of the devil. And that's encouragement for us, that in the midst of our temptations, we can turn to Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life, the one who reveals to us the truth of who we are, as the ones that he suffered and died for, as the ones that he gives himself to in the Eucharist today. That's the truth. The second thing that helped Jesus is that Jesus had a great confidence in God. Jesus had a great confidence in his heavenly Father, that his Father would always be there. The devil took him to the edge of the parapet, and he said, throw yourself off, and the angels will come and save you. Jesus had a deep confidence that God would always protect him, and he didn't need to test God, right? That's why he went back, and he said, you shall not test the Lord your God. I'm not going to test God. I'm going to be confident that he's there. I think that's one of the hardest things, though. In the midst of our own temptations, right, as we are being tempted and prodded by the devil, sometimes our confidence is not there. Sometimes our confidence isn't there. Why? Because we've given in to that temptation too many times. But Jesus reminds us in this that we can be confident that this is exactly where God wants to go, huh? This is exactly where he wants to go. He wants to go into the sin. He wants to go into that place where we're being tempted. He wants to go into the place that might be ugly or dirty or nasty or shameful and go right directly there. And that's where we can have the confidence that God wants to be there, desires to be there with us, so that we don't give in. And when we do give in, we can be confident that he has mercy on us, that he forgives us through the sacrament of reconciliation. And we can be confident that he will always forgive us that way. Jesus had that confidence in God, which is why he was able to overcome the temptation. The final thing, I think, and sometimes maybe the most important thing that Jesus models for us in the temptations that he overcame, was his prayer, his dialogue and communion with the Father. Even though Jesus was in the desert, it said what? This Holy Spirit led Jesus into the desert. God led Jesus into the desert. God led him there, and he was in constant communion with Jesus, constant dialogue with Jesus. He never left Jesus. So even though Jesus might have been being tempted and in dialogue with Satan, how did Jesus respond? With the Word of God. Because he was in constant dialogue, in constant prayer with his Father, receiving from the Father the truth and the confidence that he needed. But it was that prayer that was so essential for him. And it is so essential for us in the midst of our temptation to offer that to God. That's why the church offers us Lent, so we can go out into the desert, so that these temptations of our life can be exposed, they can come out into the open. That this place, this church during Lent, might be an opportunity to just walk into a desert and have these temptations of your life exposed, not before everybody to see, but before the God who loves you, before Jesus Christ who endured the temptations. And we can pray. We can offer ourselves. We can run in and lock ourselves in the heart of Jesus Christ in the midst of adoration during Lent. And just let Jesus see that stuff. To stop running and hiding from it, right? The desert offers us, Lent offers us this opportunity to go deeper in prayer and to let whatever is our temptation, our trial, whatever it is that's bringing tribulation into our lives, to just let Jesus see that and be with us in the midst of that, so that he converts that through the truth of who we are, huh? Through the truth, by giving us the confidence that we need that God is there with us. And then prayerfully, in dialogue with Jesus, as we tell him what is tempting us, what is most difficult in our lives, then he can help us to overcome so that we don't give in, so that we refrain ourselves from sin. I don't know about you, but I think that's one of the hardest things to do is to overcome temptation, because the devil never stops. The closer we get to him, the more we grow in our faith, the harder he attacks. The more he tries, the deeper and the more difficult the temptations become. So we need to rest in the truth. We need to be confident and to have the assurance and the confidence that Jesus had in those days in the desert, that God will send our angels too, our guardian angels to come to our aid to take care of us, that we can overcome temptation, that sin does not get the final word, right? That God himself, through our prayer and our fasting and our almsgiving and Lent, God himself can bring us to himself, can help us overcome our temptations. So as we continue this Lenten journey, maybe that we take this time, this place, that we might offer whatever it is that tempts us the most. To call that to mind, what is the greatest temptation of your life? What is the temptation that continues to come back, or maybe even the temptation in your life that you give into the most? And to come to the desert, to allow this to be a place to encounter Jesus, to just let that lay there before Jesus, not in shamefulness, but in confidence in the truth of who you are as the one that he suffered and died for, the one that he loves immensely, the one that God wants to give all of his mercy and the flood of the array of angels to help you with greater confidence in your life to overcome those temptations, to overcome sin. This is a great opportunity in Lent. It's a wonderful time to spend that time in prayer. I just encourage you to have confidence in those three areas: the truth of who you are, the confidence of God that he wants to help you, and that prayer and constant dialogue with God is the one sure way, proven to us by Jesus, that we can overcome all of our temptations with him. Not alone, but with Jesus. Amen? Amen.